Today is the day to actually not just put everything together, but also make certain important decisions. The Honorable Minister will join us at 12:30. So we have now, between now and 12:30, we have time for two plenaries. One is, of course, what we call as we had thought of coming out with a India Charter for Rivers, but looking at the various issues and various things which have emerged, and your different suggestions, we think that it will take us more time to actually put together the charter per se. But what we plan to do today is to come out with the Delhi Declaration on Rivers. So that will be a part of the charter, but charter, because charter requires lots of other inputs as well. So we will not really bother ourselves too much on the charter aspect, but we will focus and we will discuss each and every word of the Delhi Declaration on Rivers that we would like to adopt today. So that is one, that is the first plenary, and if it is fine with us all. And the second plenary would be to actually address this question of whether we want to have something called as India Rivers Forum. And if we want, then what should be its nature, what kind of membership it should have, and how to make it functional, how to operationalize it. So these are the two tasks which are before us today. For the first, if I could request Shri Shekhar Singh Ji to please chair the plenary, and Sanjay Kumar Ji, yeah, please. Sanjay Kumar Ji, because he's joined us just today, he's the district magistrate of Bareilly at the moment. Previously, he was the district magistrate of Muradabad, where he has worked very closely with the WWF Ram Ganga program. And he has been kind of a friend, philosopher, and guide to the whole program. We are really very happy to have him here. I think he required special permission from his government to actually come and attend. And Shekhar Singh Ji, I don't really need to introduce him. He's like a doyen. He's like, if I could use the term, Bhishma Pitama of conservation in this country. So we are really glad that we have two illustrious persons to actually chair and co-chair this session. So if you permit me, what I will do is I'll show you the draft, and then let us discuss. And if you think that there are points that you have made and which have not been captured, let us try to capture those things.
I think very good morning to all of you, and the chairman, Shri Shekhar Singh Saab. Though I was not here for the last 2 days, but I've been hearing, I'm getting feedback from Suresh and Nikhil and other people what was happening here. The idea is, as the compare was sharing, that we should at least come out with a Delhi Declaration on Rivers. I think the best way would be what has come up till now could be put on the screen, and people can give feedbacks, make changes, suggest changes, and maybe add something which is new, which has been left out, and we can go on point by point, so that we can come up with and touch all the points and include all the points as possible. I think that should be the best way. I think so. That should be the best way, sir.
Try to come to some kind of a consensus whether can we really define a river. And then on day two, we had got two big sessions. The first session was to deal with what can we call as a healthy river? What is a healthy river? And the second session was, what are the threats that our rivers are facing? And then yesterday we had session on looking at river futures. What is the right path for our rivers? So what we have tried to do is we have tried to incorporate recommendations, learnings from those sessions into this document. Now, if I could maybe read, this is what we would like to present to the minister, that this conference acknowledges with appreciation the intent of the present government to rejuvenate River Ganga. Although the talk of river development in the name of the ministry is confusing and worrisome. Because while we are happy that you are saying that you want to rejuvenate Ganga, but at the same time when you say that you also want to develop rivers, that is very confusing to us. And then there is this kind of a preamble, that conscious of the fact that rivers are commons with a global, regional and local relevance. Because, and that means that rivers cannot be appropriated by anyone because they are commons. Knowing that rivers are much more than mere channels of flowing waters, because that is the common impression. They are actually natural ecological systems with key roles to play in maintaining the water and nutrient cycles.
Are we discussing the point? Can you go along?
If you wish to add or subtract.
Let us first read out the whole thing.
Okay, then come back.
Let's see all the full declaration and then come back.
Then come back. Fine. Then, knowing that rivers collect water, sediment, nutrient from their catchments and transports them downstream to the seas. That is the key role of the river. Aware of the fact that the health of the river is dependent not on minimum flows, but minimum interference with them. Aware that rivers are presently in a state of crisis, aware that the previous efforts of the state in the name of river cleaning have not achieved the desired results, aware that the health of our rivers and the ecological, economical, and the spiritual health of the nation are integrally linked. We, the delegates of the first ever India Rivers Week 2014, after considered deliberations spread over 4 days, have resolved that point number one, which is unfettered flows, aviralta. River shall have the first right on its waters. Alternate options and detailed impact assessments shall be taken up through a participatory process, including government, community and civil society representation, before any planning for obstructing natural flows of a river is taken up. Where after exhaustion of all possible alternate options. So what we are saying is that within a basin, first we have to look at all the possible options. Where after exhaustion of all possible alternate options and following detailed impact assessments, structures across rivers are considered absolutely necessary. If structures are considered absolutely necessary
across the river,
then every effort shall be made to maintain essential downstream flows, mimicking the pattern of natural flows of the river. A cascade of dams or barrages, sometimes bumper to bumper, across a river constitutes maximal interference with natural flows and shall be totally avoided. run of the river hydroelectric project for peaking purposes is a particularly destructive intervention in a river. Such a project effectively kills a river. As a first step, environmental and social impacts, including downstream impacts of such peaking operation, shall be an essential part of the environmental impact assessments. A credible independent assessment shall be done of all existing dams, hydropower projects, diversion barrages, embankments and such other structures on and along the rivers to see what changes are required in these structures and their operations, including decommissioning as an option, keeping in mind the requirements of existence and sustainability of healthy rivers. To ensure security of lean season base flows, because base flows for our rivers are critical. To ensure security of lean season base flows, large scale extraction of water through bore wells on the river bed and in the floodplain shall not be permitted without an option analysis and an impact assessment study. Now, point two is the integrity of the river. The integrity of the river system, which includes the catchment, the riverbed, and the floodplain, shall be maintained. Periodical floods are an essential part of the river phenomena. They become fierce and harmful only when they are tried to be controlled through embankments. By policy and law, the first priority of use of river water should be to meet the requirements of river health and basic needs of the riparian communities. A river is a commons which shall not be leased or privatized. So this is a repetition, but this is a deliberate repetition. While we have talked of commons as a global and a regional and a local relevance, but we have brought it back here. Then impacts on river form shall be assessed for all river projects, and all interventions shall ensure least impact on the river's natural form, which is the channel as well as the floodplain and their connectivities. Now, an embankment restricts the lateral spread of river waters and breaks the river's lateral connectivity. These provide a false sense of security from floods to people and enable new habitations in the active floodplains post creation of those embankments. This is because while low-level floods do get contained within the space between embankments, but these very embankments on breach during high floods become the reason of widespread misery and loss of life and property. So the river needs space to accommodate floods. That space shall be determined with reference to the temporal and spatial variability of the 100-year return flood and left free to the river. The dangers inherent in developing, within quotes, river floodplains have recently been witnessed with devastating effect first in Uttarakhand in June 2013 and in Jammu and Kashmir and in Assam in September. Long pending river zone regulation notification under the Environment Protection Act shall be urgently notified to safeguard the river floodplains. The catchment area is the area from which runoff streams flow and combine to form a river. The vegetation on the catchment holds back the soil from being loosened and increasing the sediment load on the river. The protection of the river therefore requires the protection and restoration of the catchment, its soil, and the riparian vegetation. The riverbed is a vital part of the river. Sand mining from the riverbed amounts to the removal of a vital organ of the river. Detailed impact assessment shall precede any sanction of said removal from riverbeds. Use of machinery for sand extraction shall be prohibited. Now, the reason why we have brought this here is sand removal from rivers is age old, but this was being done by people, local people, in some sense, in a river friendly manner. But once the machinery has come in, now those people have lost their livelihoods, and then all the mafia and whatnot have come in, and they have no consideration for the river whatsoever. Traditional use of rivers for navigation and commerce is well known. But this was before the period when barrages and dams on rivers, with the objective to divert round the year, large portion of the river's flows had not been raised. With highly restricted lean season flow nowadays, the river's ability to support navigation is extremely limited. Current plans to turn rivers navigable once again through active human intervention, like dredging and creation of barrages, to further impound the river waters is fraught with grave dangers to the river system and shall be avoided. Nature has linked number of rivers with one another in an intricate network that goes to form the basin of a river system. Within a basin, the smaller rivers meet and lose themselves into the larger ones. The larger one then conveys the combined flows of all to the seas. Engineering projects like interlinking of rivers, which plan to divert flows from one river basin to another, are without any scientific justification and are unnatural. I would like to emphasize this point. This is an unnatural project and hence shall be avoided. Now, protection from pollution. The best protection of a river from pollution is the complete prevention of pollutants and contaminants, even after treatment, from entering the river. Now, cleaning up of polluted rivers cannot be seen in isolation. Cleaning shall be seen as a natural corollary of the process of river restoration. A truly aviral river is naturally Nirmal, because till date, the entire state machinery had been after only trying to convert our rivers into Nirmal, without actually appreciating this fact that a aviral river is in a sense a Nirmal river as well. And when we say Nirmal, it is clean and wholesome. It is not RO water. We don't want RO water to flow in our rivers. We want nutrient laden, wholesome water to flow in our rivers. Sewage from human habitation is a useful resource for the farm sector. Cities must plan on robust management, collection, treatment, and use of its sewage. A river and sewer, untreated or treated, should have no link. A reuse plan must be drawn up for each major sewer in urban settlements, with priority for use in proximity, be it for non-potable domestic use, landscaping, horticulture, or urban farming. Similarly, river is not a receptacle for effluent from industries. Industries shall plan and implement zero discharge practices, with in situ reuse of treated effluent wastewater in its entirety. Fortunately, just for your information, let me tell you that a decision has been made in Delhi that within next 3 years, not a drop of sewage will be allowed to enter into any of the stormwater drains and then reach the river. So in 3 years time frame, the Delhi Jal Board has actually put it a plan where they would, because the majority of sewage today entering the stormwater drains and reaching the river is from the seaward part of the city. Majority is from there. So they have said all the seaward part where there is leakage and it is entering, we will plug all those leakage, and they have a plan within 10 years to cover the entire city with 100% sewerage network. But whatever sewage today is entering the stormwater drains, they have said within 3 years, we will ensure that it does not enter the stormwater drains. So in a sense, Delhi has already taken that first step.
There was a plan earlier that we will have a sewage drain.
A parallel to the river. And take away all the two a super sewer.
But
yeah.
But there was a
objection that after all there is a Delhi border. After that there is UP and Haryana on one side, UP on the other. And are you going to take Delhi straight into some other state?
Exactly. So, also, that plan did not take care of the stormwater drains. That plan presumed that the stormwater drains will continue to carry sewage, which made little sense.
Actually, so, I was involved in discussions with them because of my case regarding
them. Can we, if you don't mind, let me finish, then we'll come back to this. Otherwise,
some detail about the decision taken. I just want to point out that there is that decision still pending, that they would have a parallel sewage drain to take all the sewage of Delhi outside Delhi.
Sir, today at the NGT, that decision will be actually taken care of. Today there is a decision in the NGT. Now, it shall be first understood, National Green Tribunal.
National?
Green Tribunal. Now, it shall be first understood as to why, despite river cleaning being a state policy and large amounts of money having been spent on it since 1984, no river in the country has been cleaned till date. So this is first, we must understand why. Our reliance on major infrastructure projects and centralized sewage treatment plants at huge expense have not succeeded. We shall go for decentralized treatment, reuse and recycle model and use more non-electric, non-mechanized, low-cost options for sewage treatment, including resort to eco-sanitation toilets. Other actions. Rivers as a cultural, ecological and social commons shall be legally acknowledged. Now, as you can see, this is the third time I am using the term commons, because we really want to emphasize this point. River does not belong to anyone. Like yesterday, the Honorable Justice Madan Lokur said that the public trust document, the principle of public trust needs to actually apply in case of rivers. And when we apply the principle of public trust, the public trust doctrine, then rivers have to be treated as commons. Annual status reports of rivers shall be prepared and made public. And we would like to add here, like it was actually somebody made this point yesterday, that we should have a red list of rivers. Like we have red list of species, we should have a red list of rivers and ensure that through that publication of red list, we are improving our rivers. Hydrological data on rivers shall be made public, because this is a very serious problem of dealing with our, at least the Himalayan rivers. Communities and Panchayat Raj institutions shall be at the focus and the primary stage of river basin governance, as they are the primary stakeholders in ensuring continued health of rivers. River watch programs and networks, including village, town and civil society representatives and local college university officials, shall be promoted all over the country as a means to mainstream the cause of river conservation in the country. Demand side water management shall be introduced in urban areas and industries. Moreover, increased irrigation efficiencies through adoption of appropriate cropping patterns, minimization of virtual water export, and promotion of natural and dry land farming, and such other water conservation measures shall be taken up in every district, region, and river basin. So river basin needs to be the unit of that planning. The existing institutional arrangements, including regulatory mechanisms on rivers in the country, shall be revisited and reformed in a participatory and transparent manner. All infrastructural planning with a potential to impact the rivers shall be transparent, consultative, and based on a thorough, cumulative, strategic, and environmental impact assessment procedure, with the underlying principle that a river has been inherited by the present generation with the responsibility to leave it essentially intact for the future generations. All industrial products, this is important, All industrial products shall have their water footprints included in pricing of the product. Cost rationalization as a policy will hold industries accountable to the costs of pollution, water overdraft, etc. that today gets externalized as an uncontested convention. Because once that comes into the product cost, then lot of products will go out of the market. And that much footprint on the rivers will reduce. Finally, the science of river. See, a lot of people don't know that river has a science. There is a science of rivers. We think that hydrology covers science of rivers. It does not. Science of rivers, which is called as potamology,